The context is that the Dark Knight Returns as a text, graphic text, is considered a pioneer in the history of graphic narratives because of the kind of paradigm shift in the art of graphic narrative it brought. So that background is with us, and we have already discussed that part when we went through those three pages written by the author. Now, after that, we also discussed one day about reading a picture, and reading a picture, we trained ourselves or retrained our eyes to divide the space into grounds as we divide our sentences into paragraphs for information or for making argument, telling the story in the word culture. We have an arrangement of the information. So that arrangement is not only found in the culture of language made of words, signs, coding and decoding, but that culture is found in almost all kinds of models of communication where a message is coded, arranged, developed into a packet in a larger scheme, if it is a novel or it is a story, and then it is delivered. So similar thing that we understood the other day in reading a graphic novel or reading a picture, our understanding should not be only based on what we see, but rather we must qualify what we see with our new training of looking at a picture and reading it. So, as you already know, reading requires understanding of that space, then grounds, foreground, middle ground, background, then any picture has the use of light in it. So these three grounds, broadly speaking, and their interactive relationship, how foreground can sometimes collaborate with the background, sometimes middle ground can also collaborate with the foreground, depending on how the visual artist arranges the space. So the word arrangement is very crucial in decoding that text. And the second word, which should be your now central word, which is design. Because you have to see that design, not design or the word style, qualifies the two important aspects, which are form and content. So form is how you have arranged the material, how you have shaped the material. Content is what it will contain in it. So the relationship between the two, for example, this cup. So this cup has a form. This cup has a form. And this form creates a capacity inside it of 100 gram or 200 gram or whatever. Now this form and content, so what it can hold. So form is something which has the capacity to hold the content. For example, a fan, the form of the fan with its blade has the capacity to rotate, to strike to the air. Every blade, next blade will strike, and then this is how the air movement will start. And inside the room, air will not be the same in one place. It will get rotated. And if you have a cross ventilation, then of course new air will also come. And the fan will, so you see the fan is a form, but its blade have been designed in a way that they are capable, if you rotate it, then they also rotate the air. That's what the thing is. Then in this kind of art, graphic art, besides the ground and the space relationship, then light and shadow relationship, very crucial. Light and shade is the art that we learn when we create light and when we have the, for example, if somebody is there in the foreground and if we throw light from the background, then the character will be dark. So you see the relationship of the light and the grounds is this, that if we are throwing light from the background towards the foreground, and if a character is sitting in the foreground, or a character or a tree or something, then that character will be dark. Now, to illuminate this character, you have to throw light from this side of the foreground towards the background. Now, so you see, this is an arrangement. Light is an arrangement. It may be natural light, which is also arranged by the sun. And the sun does not remain the same whole day. So whole, say from morning, say when it rises at 6:30, whatever times at different geographical locations, from then to the sunset time, and in between, the sun light is arranged in such a manner for the entire humanity that people receive different kinds of amount of light, different kind of slantedness, different kind of shadow, different kind of shades, etc. So whether it is natural light or it is artificially created light in a set or in a studio, or graphic designers on the page imagine the use of light. So they have to really think of where is the light falling from Every graphic artist will ask this question. Where is the light falling from? Where the person or the narrator, one who is describing, seeing it from? And what kind of eye one does have? Is it into it, out of it? Is it wide angle or what? So this is another important factor, which is of light. And then in a graphic novel, another important area is of the letters, L-E-T-T-E-R, lettering or calligraphy. Calligraphy is when you write with something. So these letters should also be read as pictures. They are as pictures. Why? Because you can create in them sense of tallness, sense of shortness, sense of fatness, sense of thinness, sense of spike, or sense of growth, or sense of, you see, that's why in most of these companies, organizations and all, when they create their the name of their company or the logo or letterhead, etc., they try to create a visual communication, a code, a message in the logo, or sometimes, you know, there are special issues, etc. So, yes, true, that Times New Roman, for example, if you want a very neutral kind of message, for example, nobody should read anything extra out of it. You only want to tell, this is Bob, and you are writing, you are using a font which is very neutral. Nobody will read more than Bob. But as soon as you create, you use a font which makes B very tall and O very small, and then B, next B is in a way falling on the ground. So the next is, so B, first B is tall, standing like an eucalyptus tree. The second O is fat, oval shaped. And then last B is not stable and it is falling. So that letter, that word with three letters, Bob, will communicate so many things. It will communicate strength, tallness. It will communicate roundedness. And at the same time, it will also communicate instability, or falling. So this is a statement by the person who designed the communication image of letters. So there is a thing called image of letters. So with this all, with having this background in our mind now, we just scroll this entire thing and try to locate patterns and see if most of the things we have learned theoretically, we are able to see them. The other day, I also differentiated the two, rectilinear, and what was the other, if you remember? One was rectilinear and the other was curvilinear. Curvilinear. So curvilinear objects are natural. And
rectilinears are something we make, like patterns. Curvilinear are like something which has curve, which is free form.
Something, yes, like plants. Three characteristics were there. One was organic. So organic, which means that all of the things which grow, including animals, including flowers, birds, human beings, all of them are curvilinear for the graphic artist. And now rectilinear means when we use geometrical shapes in, and try to see the objects around us in terms of geometrical shapes for our art. So for example, when we create an apartment, a building, so we see it in a geometrical manner. And similarly, some artists will see a camel in a geometrical way first, and they will draw the geometrical shape, then they will turn that into camel. Say a triangle and like that. So what does it mean? That this geometrical thing is used very much in the mass production, industrial world. You see, when you are making products, selling them, you use geometrical ideas, mathematical ideas. Why? Because they save your space, they save your time, you can arrange them. For example, a newspaper. So a newspaper design is rectilinear, not curvilinear, because the news items, advertisements, headlines, columns, they all put in a manner as if it is a building. But if you use a newspaper design in a curvilinear manner, perhaps you will require more 50 pages to justify. Okay. So generally, for example, let's say in our room, the way we put with the way we arrange our books, that's a rectilinear kind of thing. If you arrange your books in a curvilinear manner, then that would definitely require more space. And then, of course, your idea of classification of the books, etc., will be also questioned. Once I was there in Oxford bookstore at Knott Place, it was Christmas. It was the day Christmas, and they had developed a tree out of books. So they had designed a book, Christmas tree, which actually had all books there. So that's a design sometimes you have on different occasions, but that was a design example of curvilinear design. And they really wanted to communicate that this nature, changing season and festival, all that. So with this whole background, let's see. I have already discussed this cover page. And now you can see here in this image, there is a contrast here. For example, you see light, the use of light in the white lines. There is more, of course, there is more light falling from the behind. So light is not falling from the front. That's why this character is dark. But here, this character, you can see some face and some features. But light is not at a high intensity. And it's a psychedelic kind of light. I mean, the color, if you see, the bluish. So the character, is not a fully, you know, you don't have that skin color of the character. Rather, you know this character now from here, but the light is falling in such a manner that it has been, you see, you use different kind of, you know, techniques to create light. Whether cinema or theater or other kinds of industries. So, because colors actually communicate meaning in different cultures. Of course, they are culture-based, but sometimes some colors have acquired a status of a world culture kind of thing. Okay, but one thing is clear that colors, and we all understand colors, at least they show temperature. One meaning is this temperature. It can be cool, it can be hot, it can be, you see, very dark, it can be very hot, it can be very cold. So that meaning is that in color, if you do not have a cultural meaning of it, at least you have a memory of color because of the sun rise and sunset and whole day kind of thing. So each one of us as human have a memory of colors, and that memory has two aspects. One is the temperature. The other is the meaning, which is cultural. So one color in a Hindu culture can mean this, in Muslim culture can mean that, in Christian it may mean that. But so far as temperature is concerned, that temperature is very, very common. So Yes. Yeah. So now here we can see, after this training, we can see the use of light in this, in the, on these two pages, the cover page and the back cover page. So we can see the light now here. We can see that foreground, middle ground, and background. Can you see those three grounds there? Yes, someone please. I mean, what is the background of this entire? This is a one painting. Cover and back cover has been perceived as one painting.
Okay.
And there is a huge, interesting use of light in this. Light and temperature. Okay, light and temperature is really creating interesting context, meaning mystery, darkness, and underworld, and what is it? This novel, for example, The Dark Knight. And now the text, for example. So the text on it is, is the text very close to us? Is the text in the foreground of this? What do you think? Someone please can...
Yes, sir.
Yeah. I mean, everybody can use mic and just answer. Be interactive. Let it be an interactive classroom. This is... don't... I mean, in a way, you should disrupt the monologue, the monolithic kind of thing, you know. Yes, are the letters, I mean the words,
so the font that is used,
are they in the foreground? Let us just first talk about the grounds of this.
Yes, the division. Letters are in foreground, the middle ground.
Letters are in foreground, right? Number one. Number yes. Two, what is the middle ground?
The dark knight, the dark shape of the back.
This character?
Yes, yes.
This character. And this light is coming from the background to the foreground.
Yes, sir.
So this is very interesting. You see, this light has depth. Although this is vertical, but you see, this is how it is going. It is at this side, this is getting towards deeper inside. So it is giving, you know, a kind of illusion, like some rope or something. Is this character traveling on this light, this beam? And this is the whitest. I mean, this light is what we call overexposed. You understand this? What does it mean, overexpose? When you overexpose your camera, what happens? Someone please. Nandini or Ishika?
Sir, as far as my knowledge, when you overexpose your camera or your lens, it is so bright that you can't make out the details. It means
that the person who sees, his or her eyes cannot see the thing. Is this the thing? When you overexpose, for example, if you have a light which really is, you are using, let us say, 20 and then 100. This is the you see the bulbs or tube lights in your home. Okay, but if you go to 200, 300, 500, 1000, as soon as you go, you know, after one point of time, your eyes can't look into it because your eyes physically won't be able to survive with that light. So now that camera is an eye and light is outside. So sometimes you open the eye too much, and it takes so much light inside it. And then the picture becomes overexposed. So light spreads everywhere. So shadow or darkness and light both should be combined in a manner that the subject becomes absolutely clear. So that's the idea. But as I told you, that an artist can use overexposure for certain purposes. But here, this light does not really enter other areas. Other areas are dark, little bit this area is light. So we can see here, for example, now we can see a story here on this cover page. Cover page is not just beautiful or good or nice or what, no. For you, it is a space, number one. Number two, just imagine when it is a blank space. Number three, the space has been arranged by using color, light, ground, space, relationship, interactive relationship between three grounds. Then the textual area is also using the ground, space, text, space, ground relationship. So text will not be put anywhere, wherever it looks good. I have, you know, for example, most of the posters, most of the things that I see in DU colleges, which come from ECA or which come from all these theory areas, most of them are using the idea of what looks good. So of course, that is how you see people can begin. But as soon as you start understanding a picture technically, and you want to be a communicator, then you have to choose the ground of your text. For example, sometimes a text, when put in the background, can make more meaning than put in the foreground, depending upon what kind of depth you have, what kind of, you know. So all this is a space which was a blank space. So we created this, as I told you the other day, on a blank space. If I write something, you can read that as a number two. Then you can read that as a letter, small letter R. But as soon as you read it as a bird, then you are just including the third dimension, because then now there is a sky. So two-dimensional, our eyes have been trained right from childhood for the two-dimensional kind of text. So far as reading is concerned, our eyes have seen three-dimensionality, but perhaps in most of our cases, we are here in the classroom, our eyes have not been trained to view the three-dimensionality for reading purpose. So this is, you know, this paper is adding that kind of qualification. And here, now if I ask you, on the back cover, do you have the replication of the front cover? I mean, is there something which has been replicated on the back cover? And the foreground background relation is reversed?
So in the back cover, it is not reversed, as in there is not the overexposure of the light that we saw in the front.
No, just a minute. What I said something like this. I just explain it to everyone. Maybe the color white. I just need that. Yeah. See, where is it? Okay, it is here. Just a minute. Yes, it is here. Now, I use this. And then I use it. And then I take it like this, and then I go like this. Is this what is in the box has been taken from here and used on the back cover?
Yes, sir.
Yes, this is the point, one thing. Do all of you understand this? Yes, Nandini, do you understand this? Hello, Nandini. Okay. So this one thing is that this, now when it goes from here to here, does the foreground background relationship changes? Has the background come very close to us in this visual?
So middle ground has come very close to us.
Middle ground has come the closest. But now one thing what we notice, that this background here, which is the background, this one, this is the background. In this picture, this is not so far as it is here. And number two, it is, of course, there is a, because of light, we see the difference, but it's very close. So it means that the background has an interactive relationship with the foreground. And it depends, you see, when we rearrange things, then the grounds may also are also rearranged. So it is almost, you see, merging very close, this very close to us now, this area. If you see this, so how that did that happen? That the, now they are using this character, now taking it up from there, and you see now. So this is very interesting that here they have the text on the foreground, and this textual part they have arranged here, okay, which is also foreground, undoubtedly, but this text uses the darkness which this character has here, and it has been brought here. Now all these, you see, credits and other kinds of things, for example. So you see this credit, these credits. Now you see this space, dark space, has been used for the credit. Look at how the visualization of the visual text, how they design the paragraphs and other kinds of things. And this space has been used for the text here. Okay. So, and this has been used here. Okay. So, and so the, you see this text, for example, everybody should know it. So they assume in the marketing, say mass production, they assume that all of these readers may or may not be aware of the design and arrangement, etc., of the visual space. But most of them have been trained in their schools about how to read a text. Now, it means that this whole space has a conscious part and the unconscious part. I mean, the designs, visual designs, also carry the conscious and unconscious areas. There is a subtext, and there is a very, very clear conscious text. So the dark night returns is a conscious thing, but what is the unconscious in it? Selection of font. Now, you can make that a conscious thing as a graphic designer, because you want to address to the unconscious part of the reader. So the reader, when we look at this text, will feel better. So now, it's not just, you know, it's not just what looks good. No, it is almost like an operation. That doctors are operating, and they know their tools, they know where the heart is, they know how the heart beats, they know oxygen required, they know that these other assistants are required, they know it. It's not that they will open it without knowing and they will say and say, well, let's see what is there. Not like that. So it's not curiosity. Art, therefore, art for artists is not curiosity. Art for artists is not what looks good. For him or her, it is, as I often use the profession of carpentry, it is because that's the best example we can all understand. It is absolutely like the carpenter's task. So one has gathered that material and one has gathered the wood, and then one knows the skills, one knows the tools, and then one starts doing it, and then one, you see, dismantles everything, cuts into smaller pieces, then rearranges them, and then creates a form. That form has a content, it creates a capacity, and then it has both aesthetic value as well as the functional value in terms of carpenter. But in terms of arts like graphic novel or a poem or a painting, which do not have a functional value like a chair has where you can sit, these arts are psychological, and they use space, maybe page, paper, canvas, but all of these are things where they create illusion by means of words or by means of color, by means of light, and that illusion looks like a story, like a message, and it communicates to those people who watch that. Now they can have different perspectives to describe, interpret it. It depends on thousands of people through generations, what they want to make out of it. Meaning keeps on changing. Why? Because people's experiences change. But art, so far as arrangement is concerned, it has been fixed. It is there in that space. So this is, I think, a rereading of this page after your training in the ground-space relationship, understanding light, understanding font, the arrangement of the content on the space that is on different grounds. So that is the form and content relationship. And then we have here on this page, right now we are only looking at the visual display of these pages as on the storyboard, not really getting into the content, what is written in the words, though we have studied these pages. So on this page, what is the relationship between these two pages? If you can, what kind of shape do they make? Is it a kind of T, okay? Or is it a kind of, now, of course, these two pages are two pages, so will not be displayed at the same time. Only in the digital media we can see. But you see, as digital books have come, so maybe the designer of this graphics, who earlier did not think of it, but at least they think of the pages that open simultaneously. So most of the graphic designers, where the two pages open simultaneously, they think of the visual design of the two pages together. Why? Because the eye moves from one page to another page. The eye cannot be blocked on one page, so far as graphic is concerned. That's a human kind of thing, you know. And therefore, they keep in mind, for example, whatever books I develop by using photography, graphics, paintings, etc., I was part of UNESCO project before I joined this college in 2002. And then I developed around 20 books, and most of them were full of graphics and full of all kinds of those things. And we were a team and talking, I mean, using that entire kind of, all of these things were there. So I'm speaking from my practical experience as well. Not just, you know, that I just know them theoretically. No, I've supervised the printing press, I've supervised the team, I've supervised the photography, supervised the material, color, and all kinds of those things, including creating pictures, creating graphics, visuals, and all like that. So now if you look at here, Okay, if you look at here, the same page that we have read, but on the pages, you can see there are some pictures behind in the background. So now you can see that the text is foreground. The sketches on this are the middle ground, and the white space is the background. Can you see these three grounds here on these pages? That the text is the foreground, the sketches are the middle ground, and the white space of the page is the background. So these three things. So sometimes, you know, middle ground and the foreground clash. So they have to think about what to do. So for example, here you can see that the sketches do not use the same color which the text has been used, with the color for text has been used. So text is black here, but the other sketches black or they are blue. Yes, what do you see? Will somebody answer here? Anyone? Tushar? Isha?
So I see only the black text on the white background.
White background, black text, but the sketches are not black.
Yes,
had the sketches been black, then they would have really interfered with the letters, some letters, wherever they appear. So you see so this color actually then has a lot to do with the grounds also, because we have to take all those three grounds, communicate those three grounds to the reader, audience. Therefore, choice of color is not just, you know, what looks good, but it is also functional. So it's not the form, but it is the function. So form and function both go together in visual graphic. Okay. Similarly, this dedicated to, so this dedication you see, this is very black, and then black and white. Which means when you use black and white, what do you want to communicate? I mean, generally, there is a phrase, I've given it in black and white. Say it in black and white. We say, you know that. What does that mean when we say it in black and white? Which means there is no ambiguity. There cannot be second reading of it.
Say it clearly.
Very clearly. And you can't make, I mean, for example, you are dedicating this, so in this dedication, you are not really, for example, the color black in the dedication is erasing all other possibilities. Only communication is focused highly on the dedication part, that image and those words. Okay, so that the, now, because this is a graphic and this dedication is also a graphic, so you have to see what does this this graphic, what is the structure of this graphic, what is it communicating, and you see like this. Yeah. So we have to make out, I mean, what is it showing? What is it about? Okay. So you know that, so you can know more from, say, Will Jung Krench, 1955, 1985, not very short span. And then you have here a graphic. So if you Google Will Jung Krench more, perhaps this graphic will also start making some meaning. Is it from his, was he himself a painter or a graphic designer or a novelist, who he was? So this raises many questions. And if you can answer some of the questions, perhaps you can get into more into about it. So we can see, you see, in terms of curvilinear design, in terms of rectilinear design, for example, this page is arranged, the whole pictures are arranged rectilinearly, not curvilinearly, that these are, you see, 4, 4, 4, and like this. And in every picture, there is a space, and that space has been divided into grounds, and there is a use of light, etc. Now, broadly looking at this page, these two pages, so we can see there is temperature, for example. For example, on this, The Dark Knight Returns, this page, here you have on the face, you have this temperature. So this temperature is not, you see, is not cool or kind of, you know, ice. Ice is, you know, reflection. What is temperature? It is reflection of the light and the ground. So when light falls on water, it is reflected. Okay. And but if you put a surface there, depends upon, you know, some surfaces absorb it. For example, the umbrella. So umbrella surface black, it you know, absorbs, does not reflect. So reflection is not there, so there is no further circulation of that kind of thing. And that principle is used by artists. And that principle in art, because this is psychological space, so it creates the idea of temperature. And idea of temperature is, it has a lot, like sound. In a film, for example, you have the audio. So in a film, the audio can cause so many things. For example, one bunch of key ring where several keys are there, and if you are moving like this in a film, and if there is a sound, tinkling sound out of it, that can tell a story. Sometimes, you know, similarly, the drops falling from a leaf, tap, 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 tap. Now that can tell the story. That can sometimes make a huge conflict in the story. For example, somebody is sleeping in the other room, okay? And then there is a surface and the drop is falling, but the surface is echoing the drop, and the drop falls, and then there's trap, now like this. And that person gets up, okay? And is, now that can begin a story, that can really be somewhere. So sound, for example, in audio-based storytelling, similarly, light in the graphic-based sort of storytelling, that use of the light, like that sound use in of the drop.